So I've done this sermon. This will be the third time I've talked about this sermon today, but it's really impossible to do. The reason I'm doing it this way is because it's impossible to do not in front of a congregation. You are not my congregation, but we're going to have a conversation because this is supposed to be a homily.
Okay.
Do you know what a homily is?
No.
It's a short sermon.
I knew that.
Well, then why did you say no?
Well, see, that's one of those terms that's like familiar, but I don't know the word.
All right. So tonight, people at home, you folks have had an agape meal, I hope, which is, we're going to have ours later. Which is, you know, a love feast. And hopefully you've read John 17, which is the last installment of a very long farewell discourse by Jesus that begins in chapters 13 of the Gospel of John, which we'll talk about in just a second. Iris might join us here in just a second. So John 17 is interesting because there are two primary themes. Do you know what those themes are?
Unity is one of them.
Unity is one of them. The other one?
I almost said one because I don't know the other one.
Love. Talking about John 17.
It's a churchy thing.
We're doing a sermon if you want to join in. So John 17 is primarily about love and unity. Basically, Jesus is saying, look, God, my followers know you through me. I've loved them the way you've loved me, and I want them to continue to share the love after I'm gone, after I rejoin you. But I have a concern for them. I'm concerned that the world is going to divide them, that they'll start fighting over small things, or that worldly worries will distract them from what really matters, which is unity with one another and with God and the rest of creation. So Jesus basically says, so I'm going to pray for your protection of them. I'm praying that you'll protect them so that they can be unified. Keep them from being divided. Keep them from being separated from one another. So then he also does something else. He asks God to sanctify them. Do you know what sanctify means?
Yeah.
What?
It's like to make sacred.
To make sacred. To make holy. Good. How'd you know that word?
It says sanct, and then ify, as in sanct, the root Latin word.
Okay.
Sacred.
All right. Stop your smarty pants stuff. Anyway, Jesus asked God to make them holier in their understanding of love. So really let them understand what love is about. So once again, just to recap, Jesus is saying, my followers know who you are because they know who I am. God and me are one. My followers and me are one. Therefore, my followers and God are one.
Okay.
So, what about this business with the world? Why is Jesus asking God to protect them from division? What do you think? I mean, there's no right answer here.
Division is something that kind of naturally happens with people, like,
why?
Because of
because
of a variety of reasons. I mean, like, both on kind of like, if you think of like on an animalistic level, like people will be like, animals, including people, will be divided in order to ensure their own survival. But then also like, people will be divided in order to get what they want and do what they want. So like,
okay, so hang on a second. So people are gonna. Are going to group together for survival.
Yeah.
And so they're going to divide off from other groups that might be seen as rival to the resources that are needed for survival. So
yeah,
that's one way.
Well, that's one scenario.
Okay, yeah. And then another one is that people are just self-centered.
Yeah, or, like, not necessarily, like, selfish, but just, like, maybe, like, you want something that's, like, it's not necessary for your survival, and so you kind of, you self-separate from other people. I feel like selfishness in kind of implies some kind of violence.
Selfishness implies a kind of violence.
Well, because, like, there's, like, you can be selfish, like, within yourself, but you can have, like, acts of selfishness. And I think that's when it becomes obvious to other people that you're selfish. And you can just kind of, like, you know, because, like, to some extent, like, everybody just wants what they want, right? That's not being selfish, just kind of what one thinks. I don't think one thing is selfish as long as it's, like, certain things. And as long as you don't, like, it's the action of it that makes you appear selfish to other people.
Can you give me an example?
If I really wanted some toilet paper from Target, and, like, because, you know, I didn't even need toilet paper, I just kind of wanted some extra so I could TP in Ricky's house. Hypothetically, this is not something like that. Like, there was a bunch of toilet paper on the shelf, which there's not, but, like, if there were, I could, like, go to Target and, like, get some toilet paper just because I wanted it, and that's not, like, that's, like, an act of me wanting what I want and then getting what I want, but I'm not interacting with other people, nor am I, like, actively being selfish towards others. So it's not necessarily, like, a bad thing in that scenario. Of course, me TPing Ricky's house is a bad thing, but, like, before that
right.
scenario. But say if there was, like, only one, like, part of, hang on. If there was only, like, one pack of toilet paper on the shelf, and there was, like, a mother of, like, a family of five that actually didn't have any, and so they were trying to get toilet paper as a necessity rather than a want, then me taking that toilet paper, like, when she was present would be an act of violence against her and her family. So that's something that's selfish, and that can be division. Like, that can be divided.
Okay, so there's a difference between want and need.
Right, and, like,
when we take more than we need, that becomes want, maybe?
I think, yeah.
And that's something that else that can divide us.
Yeah.
Okay, so what else divides us?
Besides wants and, like, survival stuff?
Well, I think the survival stuff is debatable, but...
Oh, okay. Yeah. I mean, like, there's, like, just simple traits. Like, personality, different personalities. Like, people tend to group according to their personalities. That's not necessarily a bad thing. Until, again, it becomes violent against others and exclusionary.
So, do you experience the world as a divided place?
I think sometimes.
Where do you see division? Where are the top two places you see the divisions?
Politics and, I was about to say society, but that's a little bit too broad.
It is a little broad.
I don't know, probably, like, in the workplace also. Not that I've had a ton of experience with that, but I feel like, different jobs definitely create, even though you're in the same environment, they create a lot of division there.
Okay.
I feel like...
People don't feel respected.
Yeah,
people
don't
feel...
Yeah, that's one thing.
Okay. Do you think it's possible to solve these divisions?
I think, like, to some extent, yeah. Like, there's... Well... A lot, like, completely solving both workplace or political divisions would mandate a complete revision of whatever system those operate under, but I think, like, that could be done. But if you're looking for kind of less dramatic changes, it could be something along the lines of, like, maintaining the division but making it less violent. Because, like, one person being, like, disrespected by somebody of a higher rank in the workplace... That's creating a division only because somebody feels disrespected, but if that disrespect were to go away and to where, even though they do have distinctly different jobs, or one maybe, like, have, like, higher pay, that's a division in itself, but it's no longer harming anybody because there's no disrespect involved.
Yeah.
But, like, we don't live in a perfect world, and so that rarely happens.
Right. But this is why the church is really important, and I'm sorry, but I'm going to be a priest now instead of your mom.
I mean, I
know, they're listening, but the point here is that, you know, what you just said, respecting an underling, respecting, you know, somebody over whom you have power, treating them the way you would wish to be treated, that's doing something that Jesus taught us to do. Yes, there are other religions that teach us to do that kind of thing,
Well, yeah, I know, within this context.
Within our context, right? But also, why do you want, you know, why do you think, I'm not actually asking, this is a rhetorical question, you know. Jesus wants us to love others the way we wish to be loved, treat others the way we wish to be treated, because that's the way to live peaceably. This all this love business, all this unity business, it's not that everyone has to be equal. It's not that everyone has to be, you know, have the same thing. It's not, Jesus is not preaching communism. He's preaching equitability. So it is possible for, you know, a supervisor to love a staff person under him or her.
Well, of course.
The way Jesus loved him or her.
Well, of course. But even in that situation, there is a level of division, right?
Well, yeah, in our particular model of society, yes. I mean, I know you're using the backdrop of your experience at the hardware store, but which is good. But I guess I think that it's possible to have that kind of, unity is the wrong word, but solidarity.
Yeah.
You know, solidarity, understanding of one another on a global level.
Yeah.
And I think there have been opportunities to do so. You know, I'm thinking about those families down in Charleston, South Carolina, and when they were, you know, in 2015, when the shooting happened at Mother Emmanuel Annie Church, mm-hmm. all but one of those families at the time of the sentencing went and told the shooter, "I forgive you.
Yeah,
you know what you did was wrong, but I forgive you." That's some powerful stuff in a small act. Those three words, "I forgive you." It is. Forgive is only one word. Even though I put the emphasis on it.
The way you said it, I was like, wait, hang on a second.
I know. But my point here is that that's world-changing stuff right there.
Yeah. Now, like, I think we're, I don't know, I've just been thinking, like, I think in, like, in the way that you were talking about it initially, you kind of portrayed division and love as something that are, mutually exclusive.
I see. I think in Jesus's context of the Gospel of John, they are.
But, like, it's division, but then also it begs the question, is difference something that is the same as division?
You know, it's funny that you talk about difference, because one of the commentators that I read today said that there is pain in diversity, but also possibility. There mm-hmm. is struggle in difference, but also beauty.
Yeah.
And so the notion of unity doesn't mean that there isn't any difference. That's why I said it's not communism. You know, not everybody's going to be treated exactly the same. But it's the notion of in differences and distinctions in diversity that can be a really, really rich community that works really well together. And I think you need diversity in order to have something not only competent but well working.
In that case, difference and diversity is something that can give way to division but doesn't have to.
Exactly. Division is when the diversity loses its one-mindedness.
Okay.
It's possible to have unity within diversity.
See, the interesting thing, though, is, like, if you look at people, like, there is no single group of people that is one-minded. Even if you take away, diversity or any kind of difference, like, say hypothetically, you have a bunch of people who all come from the same place, they all follow the same religion, they all speak the same language, there are actually, like, no sign, like, so societal differences between that group of people, they will still be individuals, and they will not completely be of one mind,
right.
But there can still be unity found within that.
Right. There is a unifying principle that unifies people, and for the church, that unifying principle is love.
Yeah. But you like you can have unity without having one-mindedness. So you can have one-mindedness and so say take to church. You can have
let me stop you.
Yeah.
The one-mindedness that is the love.
Right, no, that's what I was about to say. You can have one-mindedness in one aspect and then individualism in another.
Right.
So like in the church you have like the unifying principle of love, and you know, loving one's neighbor as oneself. But then if you look a little bit closer within the church, or simply within Christianity is overall somewhat united by the idea of love. But in it there is
somewhat united.
Sorry, it is, yes, my bad. But like even within that there's like denominations, and within denominations there's different kinds of churches, like parishes versus missions, and within those churches there's groups, and within those groups there's individuals, and so there's always some kind of difference or different categories that exist within a larger form of unity.
So
does division have to question.
You have a question for me.
Does division like have to be present in the first place for unity to exist? Kind of like the light
and
dark.
Can you slow that down a little bit?
I'm sorry. Okay. You know the whole light and darkness principle, that if darkness did not exist, neither would light, because there wouldn't be anything to distinguish it from being the normal? Does division have to exist for unity to be present and therefore unity to be loved?
That's a great question. It might be above my pay grade.
I will answer that, and I mean you're actually asking a pretty in-depth theological question. You basically just asked, you know, do you have to have evil in order to have good? Do you have to have the devil in order to have God?
Right.
I think that in a way, yes. But at the same time, when we pursue the divine, when we pursue unity with the divine, we recognize that we are one with it, and that it is not, that our divisions, I'm starting to sound like a Hindu, it's not that our divisions are illusion, but that we separate ourselves from God.
Okay.
For a variety of reasons.
That makes sense.
Our separations from God, from the divine, from the sacred, are self-generated.
So
therefore our perceptions.
Yeah.
So this is getting a little bit far afield into philosophy.
Yeah, no, sorry. Yeah.
But I think if we, you know, keep it simple, loving others as we love ourselves, I mean, this is first thing you learn in the church. You know.
Orientation day. You're given a slip that says, hey, you're going to be a Christian now. And it's like on the back. It's attached
Will
to a little
you?
Lollipop that they hand
you. Right. No, that's good. But in the Gospel of John, what's really great about it is that in chapter 13, verse 34, the whole story that's in the Gospel of John can be wrapped up in one sentence, and that is, just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. And so there's unity, there's love, there's God and humanity together. I mean, it's just a nice little capsule, tidy and everything right there.
Yeah.
Executing that, though, is where the challenge comes in. And I think a lot of times we're afraid to actually do that. To love others as Jesus has loved us, because as we see during Holy Week, you know, there are some pretty serious consequences for loving the world. And the world will seek to divide us, will seek to cause violence of division. That was a good distinction you made. But that if we remember that, you know, Jesus is thinking about us, that God is thinking about us, don't give me that look. Always reaching out to us, always wanting to be unified with us, then I think those kinds of difficult acts are slightly easier, but are worth the power that they put out into the world, the power of unity.
That makes sense.
I think my work is done here. Thank you for helping me with that.
We have a little fuzzy friend down here whom I want to say hello.
We hope you have a good evening. And Faye says hello too.
Hey, Faye.
Oh, she's got green grass on her face. See you tomorrow.